neither do you. We're joined now out of Hobart by the Leader of the Opposition, not in the Parliament, but in the Upper House, Senator Eric Abetz. Mr Abetz, thanks for your company.
Good to be on the program.
Let's get straight into the Peter Slipper saga. Are you embarrassed, given the latest alleged controversy surrounding him, that your party endorsed him year after year for decade after decade as one of your own?
I think the important thing with the Peter Slipper incidents are these. We as a coalition were trying to get Peter Slipper out of the Parliament because of the issues surrounding him that were swirling around him. The Labor Party, in full knowledge of those issues, deliberately embraced him and elevated him to the top position that the Parliament has to offer, namely the Speakership. And that is where Ms Gillard is now hoist on her own petard. She is in a very real difficulty and she has to call on Mr Slipper to resign if he doesn't do so willingly himself.
Well, I certainly think that the Prime Minister has linked herself to Mr Slipper now, but for many decades he was linked to your side of politics. Are you at least glad that this sort of controversy didn't happen until after Tony Abbott managed to secure the Liberal leadership by one vote, knowing that Peter Slipper was the difference between victory and defeat at that ballot?
The important thing is that whilst Peter Slipper was part of the coalition, there was never a formal complaint in relation to his personal behaviour. There clearly is now, and that's going to be pursued through the courts. And I understand there are now also were investigations in relation to potential criminal activity, both of which have occurred whilst he was Ms Julia Gillard's Speaker in the House.
Senator Abetz, can I ask you about your policy area, industrial relations? The whole of the Australian business community, big, small and medium, is crying out about the damage that the industrial relations system is doing to their ability to run their businesses. Every Liberal you speak to privately tells you what a disaster it is. But it seems that you guys won't release an industrial relations policy, claim that you won't change the government's basic framework because you're scared of another backlash against work choices. Aren't you selling the Australian people a bit short in not coming clean with what your real intentions are there and releasing a full and comprehensive policy?
Greg, I don't fully agree with the scenario that you've painted, but in relation to workplace relations, we have said that we are on the lookout for the practical problems and then providing practical solutions to those practical problems. The government, as we speak, albeit somewhat curtailed, has a review of the Fair Work Act. We have encouraged employers, employees, unions, everybody to partake in that review, and we will inform ourselves as a result of that review, see what some of the issues are. We believe that union militancy is one issue, productivity another, lack of flexibility another, but let's see what comes out of the review.
Why have you committed yourselves, though, to not changing the Fair Work Australia legislative framework?
The basic framework, we believe, is appropriate, but whether or not changes can be made in relation to issues such as growing union militancy, the productivity issue and the lack of flexibility, they are all things that can be addressed within the current Fair Work framework.
So what sort of examples of that are there, Senator Abetz? What sort of things within the current framework would you see as being open to significant change?
Well, we're not talking about necessarily significant change here, Peter. What we're looking at are the practical problems that are being thrown up and then the practical solutions. And the courts, as we speak, are still going through a lot of the issues as to the correct interpretation of the Fair Work Act. And until we have some of those decisions, it would be premature of us to suggest amendments. Just one small example is the minimum hours of work for students. It used to be 3 hours. Fair Work, albeit through a very convoluted process, has now said for students after school and before school, 1.5 hours would be a more realistic minimum time. Now, that to me seems to be a practical solution to that which was a practical problem, and the Fair Work system itself worked that one out. Now, whether we can work out things such as the flexibility issues, the right to strike, and we just had a federal court decision, a disappointing one last week in the J.J. Richards case, and whether that is going to be appealed to the High Court or not, we don't know. So until such things are resolved, it is somewhat difficult to assert with any degree of being definite as to whether or not amendments are needed. So we say practical problems will be addressed with practical solutions, and we'll be announcing them well in time for the next election.
Senator, I have to say, it's one of these things where it's no wonder that the public is a little bit cynical about politics, because I'm a tragic who actually watches proceedings in the Senate. Don't stand me accused for that. But I remember during the life of the Howard government watching yourself and others arguing the case very strongly in relation to the passage of workplace reform in the final term of the Howard government. And now, obviously, having been sent a message by the public, you're on the back foot about this. I get told by your colleagues on background that you and others within the Liberal Party, particularly within the right, would like to see movement on industrial relations, but there's just the electoral realities of needing to go it slow. How do you mesh all this together and still keep the public interested that politicians act on conviction rather than on polling and messages being sent?
Well, the Australian people sent the Coalition a message loud and clear in the 2007 election, and unlike the Labor Party, we actually receive those messages, acknowledge those messages, and as a result are willing to say to the Australian people, in this instant, we got it wrong. So we are willing to say that, and that is why we have said time and time again, Work Choices is dead, buried and cremated, over and out, no longer on the agenda. Our future agenda is about providing practical solutions to the practical problems, and we are addressing them as we speak, and indeed the government has its own review into the Fair Work Act, albeit somewhat stifled by the terms of reference, but nevertheless a very important development that we will be following very closely.
Senator, what's the feeling in the Coalition at the moment with the new slipper scandal emerging, with the Craig Thompson matter apparently likely to come to a head? Is the sense in the Coalition that you might have a chance of forcing an early election after all? Are you going to be very strong in a no-confidence motion in Peter Slipper?
What happens in relation to Peter Slipper at this stage is hypothetical. What needs to happen is that Mr. Slipper needs to resign, and if he doesn't come to that decision, Ms. Gillard clearly has to prod him in that regard. There's still 2 and a bit weeks to go before the Parliament resumes. Let's hope that that is resolved.
But what's your sense, can I just ask that quickly, sorry Senator, but what's your sense on the likelihood of it? Because we've obviously seen Andrew Wilkie come out and condemn any move to retain him in the speakership, that he should be stood down pending this ongoing saga. What's your sense? You're part of the leadership group. You must have talked about this. What's your sense of a victory on the floor of the House in the lower house on this, as opposed to doing what you're doing now, and obviously the Coalition will continue to do, which is making the point publicly?
Peter, can I say that anything that might happen on the floor of the House, we would never describe as a victory, because the Craig Thompson saga and the Peter Slipper saga is unfortunately making Australia and its Parliament a laughing stock right around the world, but more importantly to the Australian people themselves. So we don't see this in terms of victory or seeing the opportunity for an election. We see it in terms of being very disappointed for the Australian people that their government and their parliament has descended to a situation where a government is being propped up by two people who clearly have a huge stench swirling around them, but they're still there supporting the government. And I think the Australian people realise and know that they deserve a lot better from their parliament, from their government.
Senator, can I ask you this? How deep is disunity in the Liberal Party over economic policy? There's, as Peter referred to, there's a lot of private chatter from people on the right who think the Liberal Party is in danger of abandoning rigorous liberal economic principles. There's a lot of chatter that Joe Hockey is not the best Treasury spokesman. You won't really release a serious policy on industrial relations. You'll have a mandate to throw out the carbon tax, but isn't there a tremendous danger that you could get into government without a positive mandate and without a clear idea about what you're going to do in terms of economic management and economic reform of this country?
I can assure you we have a plan and we have developed policies. The difficult position for us is that before the next election there will still be another two Labor budgets, all things being equal. So for us to start announcing policy when there are still two budgets to go, which could completely change the scenario. Similarly with workplace relations, if the government is serious in having a genuine look at the Fair Work Act and acting on some of the results, we may well see the government implementing changes to the Fair Work Act. This is a parliament that still has 18 months to run, and I don't think the people of Australia at this stage are expecting us to announce policies that might be completely superseded by the advent of government amendments to workplace relations or two separate Labor government budgets. So in those circumstances, to expect us to put policy out into the marketplace ready for the next election, which might be completely superseded by events, is something that most Australians understand as I move around the country.
If you accept that though, Senator, are you essentially telling us though that closer to the election we'll not just see policies, but along the lines of what Greg Sheridan's talking about, we'll see significant policies? Because the point is, let's assume for a moment that it's reasonable, as you say, not to have policies out in the ether now, because you need to see the budgets, you need to get closer to an election. I can certainly politically understand that after what happened to John Houston in relation to the GST that he put out well ahead of the 93 election. But does that mean that closer to the election we're going to see significant policies that will result in a significant mandate? Because the point still stands unless that happens, even if it's weeks before polling day. Otherwise, you win an election, you win in a landslide if the polls are to be believed, but you do it with no mandate other than to roll back a couple of Labor's taxes, and other than that, you have to sit on your hands for 3 years.
We have a commitment to ensuring that if the people of Australia do give us the privilege of being the government, they will know very clearly what we stand for and what our policy agenda will be. We're very strong on stopping the waste. We want to get rid of the issues relating to border protection. We want to get rid of the carbon tax, reduce the cost of living, ensure the government lives within its means, because this ongoing, and might I remind your viewers, $100 million a day is being borrowed today, tomorrow and the next day, and this is a debt that will have to be repaid. As a result, we will need some strong economic measures to deal with that, but until we know what's in the next two budgets, trying to predict that which we should do is quite frankly a fruitless exercise, because we need to be informed as to what's in those next two budgets before we then announce what our detailed policy and strategy would be.
Senator, you're part of the front bench, you're part of the leadership team, so I know that you have to play a team game on this, but let's judge by your reaction. Hand on your heart, are you a strong supporter of Tony Abbott's generous paid parental leave scheme?
I'm a strong supporter of Tony Abbott. I'm a strong supporter of Tony Abbott's policies, because they are the right policies for the future of our country.
Including that particular policy?
Pardon?
Including that particular policy, you consider his generous paid parental leave scheme as it is constituted now the right policy that the Liberals should not only take to the next election but be sure and enact after it, no matter what the fiscal settings?
Yes, I do.
Okay, well, that's clear.
And Senator, would you just enlighten us at all, though, about the obvious ideological disunity in the party, the sort of Malcolm Turnbull wet end of the party on social issues, and the feeling by a lot on the right that the party is abandoning rational economics? Are you really suggesting to us there's no disunity in the coalition?
Can I tell you, I've now been, in the coalition party room for some 18 years, and I have never known it to be more united and more determined to achieve that which we need to achieve for the Australian people, and that is a change of government to stop the waste, get rid of the carbon tax, and reduce the cost of living pressures that Australians are facing. So can I dispel any suggestion that commentators might be talking about of disunity within the coalition? We are strongly united because we know that the task we have is not about individuals, it is about the service to the Australian people, and that is what we dedicate it to.
Senator, before we let you go, can we spend a little bit of time talking about the Australian Greens? Now, you're a Tasmanian senator for the Liberal Party. Both the former leader as well as the new leader now, Christine Milne, hail from Tasmania. What's your view about the direction of the party going forward? I noticed that you have been quite complimentary about Christine Milne's capabilities. Do you think, however, she'll measure up, politically speaking, to the sort of performance, whether you agree or disagree with him, that Bob Brown delivered for the Greens?
There's no doubt that Bob Brown got a dream run from the Australian media right up until the 2010 election and shortly thereafter. Pressure then was started to be brought to bear on Bob Brown, quite rightly so, because he had signed up with Julia Gillard in a sort of an alliance, and the Green Labor Alliance has been a disaster for this country. As a result, the media have been putting a lot of pressure on Bob Brown and the Australian Greens, and if I might say quite frankly, Senator Brown was unable to handle that sort of questioning in a manner that is expected of, let's say, Tony Abbott and Julia Gillard. And I think he was beginning to find that pressure too much, and that is why he started to refer to certain elements of the media as the hate media, just because they were starting to question and probe that which all other politicians are submitted to on a daily basis. So his dream run came to an end. As to Senator Milne, I have said that I think there's more substance to her, but there is less of the theatre about her, and one of Senator Brown's strong points clearly was the sense of theatre, the sense of big statements, but of course the policies were absolutely disastrous, both in my home state of Tasmania and federally. And in my home state of Tasmania, we've got the double whammy of a Green Labor Alliance government in Hobart and in Canberra, and I think people are now seeing the consequences of that, and that is why for the first time in the Queensland state election, we saw not only a decrease in the Labor vote, but also a decrease in the Green vote. In the past, when Labor's vote has decreased, the Green vote has increased. So what we saw and what Bob Brown confronted was, for the first time, a decrease in the Labor vote being matched with a decrease in the Green vote. Well, and I think that spells a real problem for the Australian Greens as they move forward, because they are now tainted with the Gillard government brush, because they are in an alliance together, propping each other up, and they are both jointly and severally responsible,
Senator,
for the disasters that are confronting our country.
Well, Senator, I think everyone would agree with you that if you replicated the Queensland result, it would be a very nice outcome for the coalition. But on the other hand, isn't it possible that the departure of Bob Brown helps Labor enormously? You've got Bob Carr in the Senate now, a very big poll of media attention and national political attention. The big performer for the Greens is gone. If the Greens wither a bit, doesn't that help Labor quite a lot send some of their natural support back to them and mean they're not under so much pressure on their left. Isn't there a bit of a danger for you in this new dynamic?
As I see it, the Labor Party have betrayed their core constituency, which is the blue-collar worker voter who does not believe that the carbon tax is the right way to go, that actually believes that the definition of marriage should be maintained as it is, and as long as the Labor Party are in this alliance with the Greens, they won't be able to get themselves out of that situation that they are selling themselves out to the Greens, and that is why there has been such a big leakage from Labor, if I might refer to them again, as the Howard Battlers. They have now come back to the coalition because they see that all the big promises of the Labor Party, one, were undeliverable, but now they're selling their policy soul out to the Greens just for the sake of holding on to government for a few extra months.
Senator Eric Abetz joining us out of Hobart. We appreciate you joining us on Australian Agenda. Thanks for your company.
Thanks a lot.
Don't go away. We're going